So thank you very much for agreeing to talk with me. Could you please introduce yourself to the readers of Rope.net?
Sure, my name's Sam Ashman, and I work at the University of Johannesburg in our School of Economics.
Excellent. And what was your presentation at the conference about this week?
Well, I had quite a big topic. The title of my presentation was Finance, Surplus Transfer, and Accumulation in Africa Today. Now, to boil that, do you want me to summarise what I said?
Yes, please.
I should say it's very important for anyone who watches Rope.net, is you're interviewing me at the end of the two intense days when I'm completely exhausted and possibly verging on incoherent. But anyway, I'll give it a go. You can cut that bit out if you like. So it's about important changes in the world economy, which is summarised around the term financialisation, and what that means for developing countries and for the whole project and processes associated with development. So the big things I was talking about were how financialization originated in the core of the world economy, but has been transmitted to developing countries through a variety of ways. A lot's around speculation, so we see speculation on the price of commodities, which has meant that the price of commodities is now massively separate from the actual physical value of commodities, and that's had all sorts of far-reaching consequences. But other forms of speculation are very important. Movements around flows of capital, which are just exploiting differences in interest rates, a very, very important part of the world economy. So, you know, if you've got a lot of money and you want somewhere to do something to do with it, and you've got 0% interest rates in the United States, and you've got 10% interest rates in South Africa, you can make money simply by moving your money. But that means those elements of financialization produce new forms of instability and vulnerability for developing countries, because that means the speculation on currencies, which produces ups and downs, crashes in currencies. And, you know, crashes in currencies have huge effects. They put off investors, is one thing they do, because people think, why should I invest in somewhere with such an unstable currency? So there's all those sorts of dimensions, which have been promoted by sort of global financial elites, but have also been promoted by domestic financial elites, African central banks, African elites, and so on. So there's been it's not simply imposed by outside forces. That's one of the things I was talking about. But there's other parts of the process which are also devastating for developing economies, around outflows of capital, which are taking a variety of forms and are on a huge scale and are very significant. So we think of many African economies as poor. They've actually got a lot of money. A lot of money leaves through legal and illegal means. So I talked about some of the different ways that happens. One of the legal ways it happens is that, you know, large corporations like mining companies, which we all, are very, very present in Africa, make massive payouts to their shareholders. In South Africa, where I'm based and where most of my work is on, payouts to shareholders, they're completely legal, but the big mining companies relisted, so they're actually officially often London-based companies, shareholders in London. So there's an expatriation of profits to shareholders, vamoosh, straight out of the country, completely legal. So profits and interest payments. But there's also illegal flight of capital. This takes different forms as well. There's transfer pricing, whereby big corporations essentially fiddle their figures. But there's also very, very now, very common tax avoidance. We all know about the emergence of tax havens. So there's massive tax avoidance, which reduces the tax base in developing economies, so that reduces the possibilities for redistribution. So you get, all sorts of vulnerabilities and crises from these sorts of financial flows. And you also see, shall I carry on?
Yeah!
I could keep going for some time. What's that for? Oh, okay. You're very kind.
We must say it's quite warm here.
It's fine, don't worry. You can leave it in, cut it out, do whatever you like.
You were talking about, in your presentation, a little bit about steel.
Yeah.
And the role that financialization has had on the steel sector in South Africa.
Yeah. So the steel industry is a very important example because steel's such an important feedstock into so many different industries. You know, it's vital. There aren't substitutes for steel, and you know, it's vital for so many different sectors. I don't think it's a dirty industry, but I'm not sure. Right now, I really want to live my life without steel. But what you see is it's been privatised in South Africa, so it's privatised, and that there's been a sort of global restructuring in the steel sector. There's the big corporations, private corporations, have bought up as steel's been privatised. It's been bought up into private hands. So that means that you've got big players, but they're heavily indebted because they've bought all these companies. So what you see in South Africa is after privatisation, it's eventually run by ArcelorMittal, which is the biggest single steel producer in the world. And it does, you know, it's very non-developmental because it charges local consumers of steel import parity pricing. So you can buy steel. And you know, you're 2 miles down the road and you pay the same price as though you've imported it. That's been a very big issue in South Africa. But also the money from the South African wing of the operations has been exported back to help alleviate the debt burden that the parent company faces. There are lots of other issues, but clearly that's very, very important. And so there's been a lack of investment in South African steel. Investment's been concentrated in Europe and the United States. And so when the crisis of the steel industry sort of was kicked off by Chinese dumping, it's produced a massive, massive crisis in the steel industry, as in other parts of the places, and there had to be a government bailout to essentially stop the complete collapse of the South African steel industry. Which, you know, look at the size of the continent of Africa. Steel is only produced in South Africa and the Maghreb, in small volumes in the Maghreb, in Egypt. You know, that's a devastating impact, and it's crazy because there's steel capacity making in South Africa. There's iron ore, there's chromite. You know, there's the knowledge and the know-how, and yet it's on its last legs. So that's another important dimension, I think.
Well, just before we finish up, I wanted to ask if people are interested in this kind of analysis, what would be the key things for them to read, either of your work or of other people's work, that you think are helpful in understanding financialization and development in Africa today?
Well, that's a good question. That's a hard question. I'm not sure I know the answer to that. I'm still thinking of all the things I still quite like to say about, you know, non-financial firms and restructuring of production because of financial motives and so forth. I've used the work of Ben Fine quite a lot, who's at SOAS. I find his work useful. I use the work of Kostas Lapavitsas, who's also at SOAS. I find his work very useful. There are slight differences between the two of them. Mm-hmm. I tend to agree with Ben Fine, but that doesn't really matter, I think, for readers. If you're interested in its impact in South Africa, and myself and other colleagues have done quite a few things. We had a piece in Socialist Register a few years ago which sort of summarises the argument. Work by Siraj Mohammed and Susan Newman is very, very good. Leeds University Coordinator for Program called FESOD, which has a huge variety of working papers on elements of financialisation. As was mentioned today, Sarah Bracking from ROC's got a very useful book on finance and development that people might want to look at.
So just to conclude, what are the things that you have found most interesting about the conference? New insights or things that have kind of got you thinking about things?
I think that, you know, bringing activists and academics together is a really worthwhile process. We don't do it enough. You know, I sit here, I won't lie to you, I sit here as an academic who doesn't do this enough. Mm-hmm. So it underlines to me the sort of responsibility that we have, that our work tries to address the actual questions that are thrown up by the real world. They're thrown up by the real world and real material processes in capital accumulation and capitalist development. But they're faced by millions of people on the ground every day. The people are at the sharp end, and academics like to moan, and we moan real well about all the problems of academia, but when you listen to the actual problems of people in the sharp end in the developing world, it's extremely good and extremely important to remember mm-hmm. how actually how, to be humble mm-hmm. and to think, actually, how can I help? I don't mean that I can immediately make my work accessible to millions of people. I don't have any such grandiose ideas. Mm-hmm. And when you're writing as an academic, you use theory and you use concepts and it's not immediately accessible. But actually, there are lots of activists, serious activists, who need sort of theoretical view, who need answers, who need strategic help in terms of all sorts of questions. And actually, academics can help a bit. Mm-hmm. And to take that seriously and to regard it as an honour and a privilege and a responsibility, mm-hmm. I think it's very good to be reminded of.
Okay, thank you very, very much, Sam, for speaking with us. And I hope you enjoy the final moments of the conference.
My pleasure.
Okay.